So if you're not, if you have a lot of work pressure or study pressure and you're not able to focus on our bhakti because of that, what can you do? Yeah, it's natural. See, it's like if you're going on a, if you're driving somewhere, the traffic is very much. Then naturally we're forced to go slowly. But eventually when the traffic clears, then we can move faster. Similarly, sometimes in our life, the traffic of our academic responsibilities, of our family responsibilities, whatever, the various aspects of our life, the traffic becomes a lot. So during that time, we move slowly. And once the traffic clears, we can move faster. So it's a, there's a purpose and there is a pace. So we don't change our purpose. Our purpose is to still keep going in the same direction. We want to go towards Krishna, but the pace can be adjusted according to our particular situation. So we will not be able to always do the same activities, that same level of activities that we were doing earlier. If you have exams coming up, you have some major project coming up, you have some other urgent assignment, then that's the time when the traffic is more, so slow down. So then you slow down, that means you know, do what is required over there and then come back, and after that you resume the pace. So the test is that, say after the traffic clears, then also if you keep going slowly, then that means you are not interested in going there at all. Mm-hmm. But after traffic clears, you can make it faster. So that's one thing, that don't think that you don't have to equate spiritual life with a certain pace in spiritual life. Sometimes the pace will be slower, sometimes the pace will be faster. But the change in pace should not lead to change in purpose. Purpose is, I want to go in this direction, but because of traffic, I'll go slower. When the traffic clears, I'll go faster. That's one thing. Second thing is that even with respect to our spiritual practices, sometimes we think of our time in terms of our schedule. Okay, in this morning I have to do this, afternoon I have to go to these classes, then evening I have to go for this particular thing. So we think of our time in terms of activities. This activity, this activity, this activity, this activity. However, a time is taken not just by our activities, it is also taken by our thoughts. Okay, suppose you go into a class and you greet someone and that person snubs you. Immediately you get so angry. How dare this person snub me? Next time, in public, in front of everyone, I'll snub this person. So now that thought, that anger, that resentment, now that may go on within us for hours. In terms of our schedule, what happened was that we were in the class. Okay, I was in the school for next 3 hours. But in terms of what I assimilated, it was nothing. Those 3 hours are actually taken by that one thought of resentment or revengefulness. So like that, when our thoughts go wild, they take a lot of our time. And that is an invisible time sucker. We don't notice that. But if we are practicing our spiritual life, if we are chanting, if we are doing some reading, if associating, then that helps us understand that, okay, I'm not my thoughts, I'm not my mind. I'm different from this. And this thought has come, let it be stay for some time, it will go. So we don't get carried away by our thoughts. And therefore, we will find that the time that is wasted on stray thoughts, that will decrease significantly. So in one sense, bhakti seems like, oh, I have so many things to do, and bhakti is one more thing to do. But in another sense, bhakti is not just another thing to do. Bhakti is another way to do. The ways when we connect with Krishna, our thought energy becomes stabler. And then whatever we are doing, we can focus more. So even if bhakti seems that because I have a lot of work pressure, I don't have so much time. It's true, but actually it's not just because of the work pressure. It is the work pressure causes us stress, overwork, anxiety. And often that anxiety consumes a lot of our time. So we find that I have a lot of work to do and I'm so much stressed out that I'm thinking, writing, studying, but nothing is going in. take some break, take a few deep breaths, pray to Krishna, we chant a few mantras, maybe hear some kirtans if you like. Calm yourself down. What would have taken 1 hour to do, you might be able to do it in 30 minutes. And you did that, took that break for 10 minutes, you still again 10, 20 more minutes. So don't think of spiritual life only in terms of, okay, it's one more thing to do, I have so many things to do, how can I do it? You see, actually bhakti practices will save our time. They won't necessarily take away our time, they will save the time which is taken away by stray thoughts. And thus, even we seem to have a lot of things to do, we'll be able to do them better. Okay. So, there was another question about, who had asked about Gorodhan Eco Village? Had someone asked?
All of these people discussing about
Okay, okay, fine. So, was there anything specific you would like to go? What is the question? Or you just want to know about the place? Or
is it possible to organize a trip for all the kids, all the youth?
Well, from their logistics point of view, it's just wonderful if you can go there. From here also, if you can work it out. It's a very wonderful trip to India. And all of you have been to India basically, many times? But not to Gorodhan Eco Village? No one, huh? You also not been there? You left in which year?
2013.
Oh, that time it was just developing. Okay, good. She is from Pune, that's how I know her from before. She's of course now from Silicon Valley. Okay. So, it's basically they have a beautiful staying facility, they have very beautiful natural scenery, and they have not just scores and scores of cows, they have horses there, horse riding is there. You have yoga exercise, massage, swimming. So it's a gamut of activities, and on top of that, there are thousands of students from the various schools in Mumbai who come there. Every month, there are buses full which come there, and they have a natural experience. So basically, the vision over there is that spirituality, nature, and comfort. All three are brought together. Sometimes when we go to a natural place, it may not be very comfortable. You live in a forest or something like that. There, of course, there is also one place which is, there are different places where you can stay. There is one place called Jungle Villa. Jungle Villa is where you actually stay in the forest in tent-like structures. They're not tents, but they're just like, they are structured above the house. You can see on the Gorodhan Eco Village website. Jungle Villa is a very beautiful place to stay. So, there's a lot of things to do, fun, and if you plan it out, then there can be some kind of retreat over there also, where you can have kirtans, you can have fun, you can have swimming, you can have some talks also by devotees there. It will be a very rewarding experience. Just now, before I came to America, actually I went to Australia and then I came to America. So before that, we had taken about 25 Americans. These Americans had not even gone to an ISKCON temple. They literally from the streets of America, they had come for a trip to India. And they came to Gorodhan Eco Village. And it's a memorable experience for them. So many of them, that is the first time, they came very close to cows. And they have everything oriented for people who are new to spiritual culture. So they train you how to milk a cow. And then, has any of you milked a cow? Oh, really? Where, here?
We have a cow.
Oh, impressive.
Yeah, we have a farm of what's in gold, that's where our
milk comes from. There?
We have some milk in the temple. Every Sunday we pick it up for a whole week.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Yeah, it's Algaria farm.
Excellent. Oh, so
we have actually gone to the trip to the farm and we milked the cows.
Oh, beautiful. So you like it? Will the cows kick you?
They are really?
You try carrying?
Okay. Yeah. So of course, that's the attraction. But there are many other things also which you could do over there. So you, if you get in touch, they have a structured program for kids who come for 1 day or 2 days. They stay overnight. They have a picnic format. But if you plan it out, something can be worked out. If somebody's accompanying from here, you could have a very nice trip over there. It'll be wonderful. Maybe some vacation you can plan it out. So you have seen the Govardhana College videos and everything?
Yeah.
Have you seen the pictures of the Madan Mohan temple? Recent one. It's a majestic temple. This new temple has just come up now. So originally in the 16th century, 16th-17th century, it's a temple in Vrindavan which Aurangzeb broke. You know Aurangzeb?
Yeah.
Who is he?
He was like this Muslim emperor and he wasn't good.
He translated his idea of devotion to Islam into intolerance toward all other religions. So especially anything that seemed to challenge in his idea, the position and prosperity of Islam, he attacked that. So at that time, when he was going to destroy the temple, the devotees came to know about it and they took the deities from there to a place in Rajasthan where Hindu kings were ruling, Rajput kings. So there now is a small place called Karoli, where the temple is there. So Karoli has the deities, Vrindavan still has the temple. The temple was destroyed, but it was reconstructed again. So now what has been done is that, so there the pujari from Karoli had come there. So he was appreciating the devotees and he said that, you know, you have united Radha Madan Mohan with his temple now. So beautiful Radha Madan Mohan, beautiful temple. Magnificent structure. So it's, they also have yoga training for people at different levels. That also can be learned. So it'll be wonderful if you can go there. You remember the third, there was one third question, do you remember that? The third question, do you remember that? Yeah. Peer pressure is, that's okay, it's not going to fall. So, peer pressure is usually a problem because we all have a particular social circle and every one of us has a need to belong. We want to belong to some group because nobody wants to be rejected or neglected. And it's interesting that, you know, there was an experiment done, or not just one experiment, many experiments were done on animals. So how animals also socialize. So if say even there are small mice, they also play with each other. And when the mice play, how it is, if say the mice have their own version of wrestling. Now you say if one mouse is significantly bigger than the other mouse, then if the two are going to wrestle, what is going to happen? Bigger mouse is going to win. But if the big mouse keeps winning again and again, after some time the small mouse will stop playing. And then after some time the small mouse has to invite the big mouse to play. Otherwise the small mouse says, I don't want to play only. So then what happens is the big mouse, although that big mouse can win all the time, but the big mouse voluntarily chooses to lose for about 30% of the time. And that keeps the play as some fun. And that's how the two, that's how the game goes on. But the point is that, why am I giving this example? That for socializing, even if a mouse wants someone to play, another mouse to play with, the mouse cannot always go on winning. It always goes on winning, the other mouse stops playing. So for all of us, we have to find out the best way we can interact with a particular group of people. So if you are now here in the temple, then you have a large, you have some your friends where most of them share your values. And all of you are from more or less similar backgrounds, from India, from you have some spiritual understanding. So here you will have like-minded association. And if you get your inspiration and your values from here, then we, as I said, we all need acceptance. So if you get acceptance and the sense of belonging here, then in your social circle, in your schools, in your colleges, in your future workplaces, that whether you get acceptance or not, you will not be emotionally dependent on that. You will naturally want it and seek it also, but you will not be dependent on it. When we become dependent on something, then we just let those people manipulate us. You know the story of that horse and father and son?
Oh, no.
No?
So,
yeah. Okay. So, once a father and a son went to a market and they saw a horse. Hey, this horse is very good. Something. Yeah, sure.
You can just
What is there to laugh? No, I'm trying to understand the humor.
Okay, so basically like the door has been opening repeatedly.
No, but you did laugh at the door opened. You laughed and he said you can text me.
I think it was just surprising. Like, nobody expected anyone to talk because
Are you trying to massage my ego? Is it that you want me to text him and finish this class immediately? Okay, no problem. Maybe Vata, you should keep the door open only. No, keep it open only. So whoever comes in, they don't have to knock and check. They did some experiments with monkeys. That what happened is, you keep a monkey and there's like a wall, and the monkey can with great effort climb the wall and go on the other side and see what is there. Now when they kept the monkeys over there, more than the, if they had some food, they would eat the food, but just out of curiosity, the monkey would climb over, see what is there. So what is there? So similarly, whenever a door is closed, people want to know what is happening behind that closed door. So that urge to know is there in everyone. Anyway, so coming back to the point of peer pressure, so we need a sense of belonging somewhere. So where we get it, that's important. So if you get it in your devotee friends over here, then even if you don't get it entirely or immediately in your social circle, in school or whatever, it doesn't matter so much for you. You won't be dependent on it. And generally, we can, so I was telling the story of this donkey, not donkey, the horse. Okay. So the two father and son went to a market and they saw attractive horse. They said, let's buy this. They bought the horse, and then both of them were, they got on the horse and they were riding it. And some passerby said, what is this? Now this is cruelty to animals. Two of you, both of you are riding on this horse will get crushed. Then the father thought, okay, I'll climb down. Son, you can ride. Son was riding, and then some passerby said that, what is this boy? Does he have no sense of decency? He is young and healthy. His father is old. He is riding the horse and his father is walking. Shame on him. Looked at each other. The son got down from the horse. The father climbed up the horse. And then, as they're walking along, some people said, now what has happened to parental love? The father is comfortably riding and making a small child walk. Doesn't the father have any concern for the child? And then the father said, okay, I'll also get down. So the father, the son and the horse, all of them walking. And then some people said, don't these people have any brains? What do you have a horse for if you're not riding? So, now whatever we do, there'll be people who will criticize us. So, some people will think, hey, this is fashionable, wearing a dress like this, having a haircut like this, doing that. But Oscar Wilde was a prominent, you heard Oscar Wilde? Oscar Wilde. So he said that fashion is a form of ugliness. so intolerable that we have to change it every 6 months. So what is considered fashionable now, after 6 months, it becomes old-fashioned. And for somebody who wants to be fashionable, there is no put down, no insult as unbearable as being told, oh, you're old-fashioned. So if we are too dependent on other people's opinions, then we will not be able to do anything in our lives. So yes, when we want to belong to a friend circle, you can find out what are the things which you can share with them. And if they pressure you on some things, just, you know, this is what I do, these are the principles I live according to. And if you don't submit to that, they won't push you too much. There's a little bit pushing will happen, but after some time, okay, this is how this person is, they'll accept it. So what happens is that each of us needs to have some strength, some resilience. If we just bend to anyone and everyone, people will keep pushing us down. So you need to be assertive about your values. But be assertive, not aggressive. Say somebody asks you, okay, but why don't you eat meat? Or why don't you do this? Why don't you do that? So there are three ways in which you can answer the question. If somebody asks you, why don't you eat meat? What will you answer? It's cruel to animals. That's one answer. Any other answers?
I'm vegetarian. It's my choice not to.
It's my choice. Okay, that's fine. Any other answers? Has anyone asked you? Have any of your friends asked you, or nobody asked you also?
They just say you're missing out.
You're missing out.
Usually, otherwise.
So what is the peer pressure about primarily?
I think at one point with peer pressure, you just gotta understand that if you have enough faith in what, like, in your Krishna conscious beliefs, it doesn't really matter if people say you're missing out or something, because in reality, it's not right to be.
Okay. Now, so what do you feel pressured by your peers about? That's a good point. If you have faith in Krishna consciousness, that does work. So anyway, I'll not get an answer, but I'm making a point that when we present if somebody asks us, why are you doing this or why don't you do this? There are three ways in which you can present it. I call it as prescriptive, normative and descriptive. Prescriptive means giving a prescription. No one should eat meat. You should also not eat meat. Who are you to tell that to me? And when you give a prescription to others, others feel you are imposing yourself on them. Normative is meat eating is not right. And then immediately, why do you say it's not right? I'm doing what I want to do. Like you say, it's your choice to not eat meat. It's my choice to eat meat. So normative is also, what right are you saying this is the norm? But descriptive means, this is what I do and this is why I do it. So you could say the same point, it's cruelty to, instead of saying it's cruelty to animals, directly saying that you could say that, you know, I actually watched some videos or saw some pictures of how animals are treated in the factory farms. And see the brutality against them, I felt I don't want to be a part of this. So what happens? By this, you are conveying your conviction, but you're not necessarily making the other person feel bad about it. When you just say it's cruelty to animals, oh, that means what you're saying is, I'm being cruel to animals. You're saying to the other person. But they feel a little threatened by that. So if somebody asks us why we are doing something, why not doing something, you can just be descriptive. Descriptive means, this is what I do, this is why I do it. So if you do it like that, then you won't lose any friends because of whatever practices you have. Because, okay, nowadays the broad environment is multicultural. So you can do what you want, I'll do what I want. Okay. So any other questions? Does it answer the question about peer pressure?
Or like you have to do it, or like how do you motivate yourself to change?
How do we motivate ourselves to chanting? That's a question I ask myself every day. It's a challenge for all of us. I'd say that we all have to find out how we can work best with ourselves. In our, when we are living, there is self-discipline and there is self-discovery. Self-discipline means that this is what I am going to do. We decide to discipline ourselves. But we are not our own slaves. That what I decide, I am going to do it. We can't make it like that. We are not our own masters. That we can make ourselves do whatever we want. But there are some things which are self-discovery. Okay, this when I do, it feels good, I can do this nicely. This when I do, it's a little more difficult for me. This is unmanageable for me. So there is some aspect we discover ourselves. So it's good to observe ourselves. Like say you meet a new friend, then you'll observe that person carefully to understand them. Okay, this person thinks like this, this person does like this, this person has this habit, this person doesn't like this, this person doesn't like that. So like that, same way, you can observe yourself. Look at yourself as if you are someone you don't know. Now, do you know yourself? Little bit actually. No, our mind is complicated. There are so many desires, so many thoughts, so many ideas. So sometimes we surprise ourselves. And sometimes, many times we shock ourselves. Isn't it? We do something and, hey, why did I do that? Or sometimes we do something very well. How could I do that? I didn't know I could do this. So both ways it works. So we observe ourselves as if we are someone we want to know. And then you find out on the days when your chanting is good, what did you do before that? Was there something you did? Then you'll say, okay. So before my chanting, if I take a few deep breaths, if I pray, take darshan of Krishna, that helps me to chant better. And if I just come from work or if I just done 2-3 other activities and then I just pick up the beat and try to chant, I just don't connect. Then I feel bored. So observe yourself and try to understand how you can work best with yourself. So instead of saying chanting simply as a practice for as a ritual or a requirement or a rule, because chanting can also become a means by which we understand ourselves better. We understand our mind better. So generally, there is a spiritual connection with Krishna that is established through chanting. The sound vibration of the soul of the holy name connects the soul with Krishna. But sometimes the spiritual connection is not so easy to establish because we are not in spiritual consciousness. So then we need to establish a connection with Krishna somewhere else. Physically, mentally, intellectually, some other way. What does that mean? That means that you can keep a picture of Krishna in front of you and just look at the picture of Krishna, try to describe in your own word the beauty of Krishna. As you do it for 1 or 2 minutes also, it will stimulate your thinking, stimulate your emotions. If you have a favorite pastime of Krishna, keep a picture of Krishna with you in your pocket or somewhere close to you. And then you look at the picture, remember the pastime, you speak the pastime in your own words. That will stimulate your thinking. And then a connection at an emotional level, a connection at an intellectual level will happen. If you have heard some good points in a class about how the mind needs to be controlled, you could write that down as a quote, keep that in the diary, and then just read that quote, maybe speak it, verbalize it a few times. So that will kickstart your intelligence and the intellectual connection is established. If you like kirtan, then just if you like a particular tune, then just before you start your chanting, japa, just sing that kirtan 3-4 times. Sing the Hare Krishna Mahamantra in that tune a few times. So that will stimulate a musical connection with Krishna. So we want to establish a spiritual connection with the holy name, but till that spiritual connection is established, we can establish some other connection, an intellectual connection, an emotional connection. Sometimes, if you're just tired and bored, just if you walk and chant, a physical movement, you know, you look at some pictures of Krishna if you have in your room, and looking at them, you chant. So this might appear as if our mind is wandering, but rather what we are doing is, instead of having the mind focus on the holy name directly, that's the point of concentration. Around that point, there is a circle. The circle is that things related with Krishna. So if you can't focus on the point of concentration, we focus on the circle of concentration. That circle is the things related with Krishna. So, and through that we can gradually get the connection toward Krishna. And over a period of time you will yourself find, oh, these things if I do, I can connect with Krishna better. These things I do, I can't connect so much. So, even if chanting doesn't connect you with Krishna immediately, chanting will still help you understand yourself better. And when you understand yourself better, it will help you in all walks of your life. So don't see just chanting as a rule. See chanting as a resource for self-discovery. Ultimately, chanting is a resource by which you develop love for Krishna. But right now, the attempt to chant will be a resource through which you can understand yourself better. How your mind works, how you yourself work. And then you will find that through chanting you will learn about yourself and you will grow. Okay. So thank you very much. Shila Prabhupada ki. Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki. Hare Krishna.